The Cube at OpenStack Summit Atlanta 2014 is brought to you by Brocade. Say goodbye to the status quo and hello to Brocade. And Red Hat. Here are your hosts, John Furrier and Stu Miniman.
Okay, welcome back everyone. I'm here live at OpenStack Summit in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm John Furrier, the founder of SiliconANG. I'm joined by my co-host Stu Miniman. This is theCUBE. It's our flagship program. We go out to the events, extract the signal from the noise. Our next guest is Lou Tucker, VP, CTO of Cloud Computing with Cisco Systems, also Vice Chair of the Foundation. Welcome to theCUBE.
Thank you.
So great, you guys had a late board meeting last night into dinner.
It was a late dinner.
big activity. I mean, the Foundation now has done a good job of kind of putting the heat shield up. A couple of years ago, you saw everyone jumping into as one big, you know, marketing event. Oh, OpenStack's going to be this thing. And so you saw a lot of cloud washing. That was peak cloud washing days a couple of years ago. And then OpenStack clearly went in the straight and narrow on just kicking ass, taking names, code, use cases.
Well, we actually always hoped it would be like this. And that we felt that by bringing together a lot of the experienced veterans in the industry who are on the Foundation representing their companies and everything else, like, we could guide it in this way with a very strong technical component. So it's always been that combination of those of us on the board, but the real strength of the community, it's in the code that is being written by the contributors, you know, day in and day out, making OpenStack better.
We saw you talking to Eileen Evans, just was on earlier with HP, deputy counsel with HP. She's on the board with you. You guys know each other from the Sunday.
Right.
So I got to ask
you
the question. I mean, the cloud is one big distributed computer. If we're in an API economy, in a way, it's a large supercomputer. It's a large mini or mainframe.
Well, you know, having built massively parallel supercomputers back in Thinking Machines days and then many, many years at Sun, we always knew the network is the computer. And so now actually
it is.
Cisco, we're realizing that is becoming the internet is one big computer now.
And it certainly is happening right now. So like as Scott McNeely said in theCUBE, I should have just called it cloud. So I got to ask you, systems guys are back. I mean, you know, you're seeing a lot of the, you said older guys in the industry kind of coming together. That's kind of what's happening. Linux set the table as a, you know, as a cheap alternative to the proprietary stuff back in the day. Now Linux is a first class citizen in the enterprise. Now Linux built on that, and here we are. So systems is back in vogue. If you're a systems guy, it's good, right?
Oh yeah, it's cool. Now, I mean, infrastructure is cool, and actually people are asking, you know, a lot of the questions about it, and so that I think that we're seeing a resurgence in people looking at it from a systems point of view, and now it's at all the different layers, because then that's what OpenStack is about. I think it's creating a truly unique layer in the new software stack for the data center. So just like middleware years ago that we had, everybody said there's middleware, here we have TIPCO, and we've got app servers and everything else. Now I think it's this cloud platform is that new middleware that's moving into these things, and OpenStack is in the lead.
So, Lou, can you give us a little bit of insight into the inner workings of what's going on at OpenStack? You know, it's been Ice House was just released, so we're up to through the alphabet up to
right.
I.
That's right. We've made it easy for people by trying to keep it alphabetical. Juno's next.
Absolutely. But you know, people say, okay, we've been working on this for what, you know, four years or so, and you know, why isn't everything done? Mm-hmm. And you know, you and I were talking offline that you know, there's a bit of grumbling in the community that like Neutron, the networking stack, you know, has some challenges and has some problems. So, you know, what's so difficult
We've taken on a really big challenge here. This is to build in open source, a very new cloud platform that anybody can take and deploy their own Amazon in-house, you know, for a variety of different use cases. So the use cases span everything from a cloud service provider that we see, for example, HP and Rackspace and others providing those kinds of things, to somebody running it like Comcast who wants to run it on Xfinity. Those are very different sort of use cases. So that we've been fortunate because I think we structured the process around projects. And those projects are a compute project, Nova, a storage one, Swift, a networking one around Neutron. That allowed the experts to get together. If it was all one big thing, we wouldn't have made anywhere near the progress that we've seen. We still have a long ways to go. I mean, I think that we're seeing very rapid adoption, but it is by people who actually know they have to take on quite a bit. What we're trying to do, and it was even mentioned this morning in the keynote, is a company like Comcast now is a contributor. So this is, I think, the new phenomena that companies are not looking to just be, go to a vendor and get a piece of software and install it and let the vendor do all the work. They actually want to be a part of this. And that's why we're seeing a lot of the service providers involved in an open source community. That's actually the first time I've seen service providers be actively involved in a community effort like this.
So Lou, when I think of Cisco, I think about you know the people that have built their career off of being a Cisco administrator. You've got this army of CCIEs and the
exactly.
like. It's a very different skill set than the folks that you see at this show.
Yes.
You're one of the leading people at Cisco that helped bring Cisco to.
I think we want to take that whole community of CCIEs, and we have to move their careers along.
Yeah.
When they hear that they're actually that they can. With a few lines of Python or Puppet scripts or whatever, start to orchestrate all the things that they were doing manually. They love it. It takes training, it takes education, and we are actively working with the CCIE community to educate them about this phenomena. And because it is open, it's freely available, the source code is there, you can read it, it's accessible to them.
Lou, talk about what's different about this new philosophy, because what you're essentially talking about is DevOps meets Thinking Machines meets Sun. Mm-hmm. You mentioned. Remember, you were at Thinking Machines.
Yeah.
Remember that. I remember that startup
right.
in Cambridge,
right.
wasn't it?
That's right. 65,000 processors all working in parallel.
Just amazing. But back then, that was cutting edge. But now these young developers, they come in. Oh, I'm just going to get some Rails and some MongoDB, and I'm good. I'm going to build a hyperscale company. You might be able to maybe do some hacking, but to bring this systems mindset in there, what do these guys have to do? I mean, how do you take DevOps and cross them over into mainstream? Productive developers.
Yeah.
DevOps
is that intersection of software getting involved in these operational processes that we used to do by having a runbook, and you'd have a sequence of steps that some system administrator would go through in order to provision a new employee in their database. Now we're recognizing that script that can be made into a script. So we're seeing actually between Puppet and Chef. And Python, we're seeing a kind of resurgence in these easier to use scripting languages, even though Python's going far beyond that, that are accessible into people who used to do these things manually.
With reuse, too. With reuse.
But that's the whole point. Because otherwise, you can't. We want to take that, what one administrator used to do 1,000 times, and now he writes it once and he presses a button 1,000 times.
What's going to change in open source, in your opinion? And just look around the corner. Obviously, as open source matures and matures and matures, you know, some practices, certainly the ethos has never changed, but like in terms of mainstream, what do you see changing?
Well, in fact, I think OpenStack is a new kind of open source project in which the original code development is done in the open. This is not something that was developed as a product that was then decided to open source it. So to have a community of this size working on this big a project, with over 1,000 contributors working together on these projects, just the way we manage that process itself is becoming something of an art. And so I know that you had Monty Taylor on here before. He's running the infrastructure project, being able to say, how do we get all this stuff tested? How do we get all of these releases built? How do we integrate all of these projects? We are using automation. It's all about automation, automation, automation. We have to have the tools, so it's all...
You're writing the modern book.
That's software development
in this kind of way.
Right. And it may even change the way that we deploy applications. You don't get it on a CD anymore. You'd be pointing to a GitHub repository. You know, and that
versioning control, everything integrated stack.
That's right.
All right, Lou, about a month or so ago, Cisco launched InterCloud.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering, you know, can you help us squint through that press release
sure,
as to what it
sure.
is and how does that fit into the whole OpenStack movement?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, it was recognized, I think, by Cisco. First of all, we have a lot of SaaS applications, and many of the companies that we will probably continue to bring into the Cisco fold will be SaaS-based. So first and foremost, it was started as an attempt to say, we need a place to run all these SaaS applications. And many of those, for example, WebEx was already being ported to run on top of OpenStack, and so we started to make OpenStack the foundational element for this. We then decided to go further
is Cisco actually hosting those SaaS applications at a
we
Cisco
will be.
Facility?
Yes, okay. We absolutely will be. That'll be a part of InterCloud. So part of the InterCloud vision is, and it's not just one data center, it's a global set of data centers. And it's not just Cisco data centers, but it's data centers that are provided by our partners. So we are able to put InterCloud into our larger partner community of service providers, and now take all of the Cisco services and deliver them through that kind of cloud. And so that we're doing this in concert with our partners, where before there was concern, would you compete with these service providers? We decided, and something I learned from Sun Microsystems when we were doing SunCloud, you do things with your partners, you actually have a bigger, you know, broader reach.
Right, but so it's a combination of service providers having facilities, but there also will be Cisco facilities, and there'll be
We will put the gear there, and we will run it and operate it for them, and yet they bring it into their customer base.
Can you share with us, you know, what is Cisco's, you know, obviously you have a lot of software, but when it mm-hmm. comes to SaaS applications, mm-hmm. you know, what's kind of the breadth
of one of the ones I like to talk about is, so we all know WebEx. Yep. So WebEx is obviously one of those SaaS delivered applications around the globe. Meraki, it's a change in management. So how do you now, what would enable a easier management paradigm for people who are wireless access points? Well, Meraki now does that from the cloud. I think we're going to see more and more of those applications move to the cloud for management of ordinary things like your wireless access points. Make it easier that way. So OpenStack played a key role in this because we said, what is the platform that we are going to now, what is the cloud platform we're going to use in all of these data centers? And that was, it was very clear that it was going to be OpenStack because Cisco, time and again, we're finding WebEx is going there. We're going to put Meraki there. A lot of the network function virtualization is going on top of OpenStack. Our video properties are going on OpenStack. So OpenStack is becoming a foundational element of Cisco's total strategy.
Lou, a lot of the, I was at the 30th anniversary of the Mac in Cupertino a couple months ago, because a bunch of my buddies.
Did you get a Mac one?
I wasn't involved, but I did get to sit in the VIP because some friends of mine are old enough to be on that Mac team. But it was fun to have kind of a geeky night celebrating kind of the day, talking about, you know, shoving 1K of, you know, bartering over 1K from Mac Paint and hearing the guys talk. But it really kind of highlighted what at that point was the tinkering, which is the Homebrew Computer Club. Now you're seeing that tinkering coming back, and with Open Compute, Raspberry Pi, you're seeing hardware being a big part of it. So I got to ask you, as someone who's been there, done that from a couple different cycles, you've seen the innovation. You don't have to be someone's uncle to get a motherboard at Intel. You can get it anywhere now. You can get hardware.
I have my interns are walking around with a notebook or, you know, with a little suitcase, which is a OpenStack cluster. And so they have in their 6 nodes or whatever running OpenStack. They can open it up. They can walk in. Let me show you what OpenStack looks like.
This is a huge new thing. And even at IBM Impact, we were looking at some of the things there. These young developers, they want to hook up a drone, put some hardware on it, GoPro camera.
It's a great time to be a developer here. It really is. And so anybody out there who's not coding, you're missing an awful lot of the fun that's happening today.
We're geeks. But let's talk about the Open Compute. What is that? That's a huge thing. That potentially is the next homebrew.
Yeah.
What do you think about what's going on with Open Compute?
So there's Open, I think we're seeing the sort of advantage of Open being applied in lots of these different areas, so even in terms of hardware architecture. So can we open source the architecture that we want a computer to be built out of that we can have a lot more input into it? I know it's this, even back at Sun, we were talking about, you know, open sourcing or Spark architecture. So that each one of these layers, I think, can benefit by having more and more people looking at it, more and more contributors going into it. And it does require a changing business model on the part of vendors for how then are they going to continue to either differentiate or provide the value.
It's a great time to be a developer, so I got to ask you on a personal note here. I have 4 kids, one's freshman in college. A lot of other parents I talk to have kids, and the question is, I want to get them involved in computer science, and one parent, I won't say their name because their friend, I enrolled them into a Java class. I'm like, no, don't do that. Not that anything against Java, but there's more fun to do other things. So I want to ask you, what do you see out there that would help kids get addicted to the funness of computer science? I mean, Java class for, you know, an 8-year-old, I wouldn't suggest that's my personal.
No, but Python they can do actually at that age. You'd be surprised at how young kids do when they pick up a programming language. If your kids are in college, I would have them go after mobile apps. I mean, that's also something that they could actually show to other people. There's a lot of tools out there for doing this.
They can share, do
something
quick.
They can share that, and it will mean something to them immediately.
Yeah, so instant gratification, something where they can get instant gratification.
We are living in that age.
Is there any cool things that you've seen that you'd like to point out?
No, I'm as interested actually also in the whole idea of open data. So you've got Open Compute, but Open Data, for example, in San Francisco, the city has made available the data stream for available parking lots. parking spots. So that means that people now can develop applications for their mobile phones that anybody can use to come up
with. The OpenStreetMap project was pretty successful as well. That was very open data. You know, I was talking to the founders of Factual. You know that company, Factual?
That's right, right.
Yeah, very much into the open data. And was privacy's dead edge? Privacy is going to be... Okay, we're here at the OpenStack Summit. Lou, final question I want to get you to share in your own words to the folks out there. Why is this point in time, 2014, so different than other major sea changes or tectonic shifts, or whatever you want to call it? What's so special about right now happening in the tech industry in the world?
Well, I'm not so sure it's that different than what we're going to see in the future. I think it's the beginning of a new set of changes that we're seeing. We've changed and networking has become virtualized, and that where the whole notion of what is a network is changing. We've introduced, even with Neutron, yes, it's had its rough spots because it's the first time anyone's tried to build a network as a service. So I think it's the beginning of a new set of changes that you're going to see. And people will point back to this time and say, I remember when we just sort of started to see OpenStack have its first real conference.
Remember when Lou Tucker was on theCUBE talking about that?
Yeah,
only 4,000
exactly
people.
Right.
Only 4,000 people.
Can you imagine that?
I think, new user experience. Lou, great to have you on theCUBE and hear your perspective. Obviously, your experience in the industry has been great. And to share that with us, and being involved as vice chairman of the OpenStack Foundation has been a great testament. Congratulations. And Cisco's obviously got some new activities going on. I've been following them pretty closely. This is theCUBE here live in Atlanta with Lou Tucker of Cisco Systems, Vice Chair of the Foundation. We'll be right back after this short break.
Thank you so much.